So let's get started. To begin our 2019 symposium, I really can't think of a better way to get things started with our opening keynote speaker, Mr. Blake Scholl. Blake is the founder and chief executive officer of Boom Supersonic, which was founded in September of 2014, and it's headquartered in Centennial, Colorado. Now, Blake is no stranger to new technology. He has a degree in computer science from Carnegie Mellon University, and he started his career at Amazon as a software engineer back in 2001. He eventually owned a $300 million profit and loss segment of their online marketing. He later was the first employer and director of a product development mobile startup called Pelago, and in 2010, he co-founded mobile technology startup Kima Labs, which was a mobile shopping software maker, which got acquired by Groupon in 2012. Blake at Groupon held multiple executive roles and really set the stage for his moving into this new technology of supersonic travel. Now, Blake's interests in aviation go beyond just technology. He really started as a child when his parents used to take him out to the local airport and watch airplanes take off and land. Sounds familiar. And he started flying for fun in college, earned his private pilot's license in 2008, and his instrument rating in 2011. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Mr. Blake Scholl.
Thanks, Terry, for the very kind introduction. You know, I have to say, there's nothing like working on internet coupons to make you yearn to work on something that you really love, that's really gonna matter to the world. And for the past about 5 years since I've been working at Boom, I feel like I've had my dream job every day. So as we stand here in 2019, I think it helps to look backwards 50 years. So we are now 50 years ago this year, Concorde took its first flight. And as we know, next month, we are going to have the 50th anniversary of that first moon landing. But it's a really unusual story in the history of technology that we have a capability like we had in Concorde and in Apollo, and 50 years later to have actually lost it and gone backwards. It's fashionable today to talk about what technologies are sustainable and which ones are unsustainable and what we can do to sustain our tech. But supersonic flight is literally the definition, the epitome of unsustainable. We don't have it anymore. And our mission at Boom is to bring that back and to do it in a much more mainstream way than ever before. But I'd like to start talking about why speed matters, because I think we all think, geez, less time on airplanes would be better, right? But that actually underestimates it. And I think the clearest way to see this is to look backwards at the history of flight. All of us today are too young to have really experienced what a speed up means. And so we look back at that, we could understand and motivate ourselves to build a speed up for the future. So let's imagine the year is 1958, and we live in San Francisco, and we're dreaming of a island vacation in Hawaii. So if you want to go to Hawaii in the 1950s, you have to get on a flying boat, and it's a 16-hour ride over to Honolulu. And as soon as you learn that, you probably think, like, let's go to wine country instead. And so before jets, there really wasn't much of a tourism business in Hawaii. But as we know, the jets changed all of that. So those flights from the West Coast that were 16 to 20 hours in a flying boat shrank to the 6 or 7 that they are today. And you might say, well, okay, great. So what that means is now we spend less time on airplanes, right? Because flights are shorter, more time on the ground. It's all a good thing. But something relatively counterintuitive happened, which is as we opened up, as we basically broke the time barrier to experiencing the planet, more people went more places more often. So in that first 10 years of the jet age, for example, traffic to Hawaii went up by a factor of 6. Factor of 6 in 10 years. That's the kind of growth that this industry hasn't seen in a very long time. And you saw that not just in Hawaii, but you know, any place where time was a barrier to having an experience. Across Air France's entire network, traffic grew by a factor of two in that first 10 years of the jet age. And it continued to compound for several decades as we started to see the second order effects of speed. As people started to build hotels and resorts and tourist attractions in places that were previously too inaccessible, as companies decided to put remote offices in different places, and people even expanded their idea of what a long-distance relationship could actually be. So what really happened is flights got shorter, people actually spent more time on airplanes because it was more worth going and the planet became more accessible. What's interesting, though, is it wasn't just about where you could go, it was also about what could come to you, like the Beatles. So the Beatles took the first world tour in 1964, and that's not an accident because this would not have been practical just 10 years earlier with slower airplanes. So we have the speed of the jet to thank for music being the relatively global phenomenon that it is today. We have music to thank, or sorry, we have jets to thank for the, you know, the world tour. Also sports. What does the jet have to do with baseball? Well, it turns out for about the first 70 years of Major League Baseball, this was a sport that was confined largely to the you know, northeastern United States. Because in baseball, we've got 160 games a season, and you had to get the teams from one city to another to have a match. And if it takes too darn long, you just can't do it. So you're really restricted by, you know, how far you can travel on a train in a day. But within just 6 months of the first transcontinental jet service, the Brooklyn Dodgers became the LA Dodgers, and we started to see Major League sports spreading coast to coast. So you know, next time you enjoy the big game, you know, remember to pause and give thanks to the speed of the jet, which made it possible. You also see other effects elsewhere, that things that are enabled counterintuitively by the jet. You know, one of my favorite stories is Nike, the shoe company. And you might say, what do jets have to do with shoes? Well, it turns out the founder of Nike, Phil Knight, he fell in love with Japanese running shoes after business school. And he could relatively easily in the 1960s, again, it wasn't an accident that this happened in the 1960s, was able to go over to Japan and start to build out his factory relationships and his supply chain and get that business rolling. And today, when we go running, we wear different shoes because of the jet. And so if you lived in the 1960s, you've just gone through this amazing speed up. We saw progress towards the lunar landing, and everyone believed that supersonics were the obvious next step right around the corner. And the supersonics were to be to the propeller aircraft what it had been to the Transcontinental Railroad and what that had been to the covered wagon. These were steps forward in making the planet more accessible. But it's important to notice that the genesis of supersonics in the 1960s was very different than the genesis of the previous generation aircraft. If you look at where everything came from the Wright Flyer through the DC-3, through the de Havilland Comet, the first jetliner, these aircraft were all created for commercial demand. By entrepreneurs who said, hey, I can go build something pretty amazing, and I think people want it. And they had to think just as much about the technology of what they were building as who would be able to use it and who would be able to afford it. But in the 1960s, we really made a big shift in how we motivated development in aerospace. So Concorde didn't come from a startup, didn't come from an entrepreneur, didn't come from even an established company. It was a joint venture between the French and British governments. And of course, if we think back across the arc of history, most joint ventures between the French and British government are wars. So it's really remarkable that Concorde worked at all. So in 1962, the French and British governments signed a treaty to jointly develop Concorde, and they kind of handcuffed themselves together and made it impossible for either of them to get out of the project, no matter what it looked like. And so they succeeded in building Concorde, which was a really, really marvelous technical accomplishment. This aircraft pioneered pioneered new technology in high speed. It pushed the limits of what you could do with aluminum as a material. And you know, supersonic aerodynamics for sustained flight were really figured out for the first time. But in doing all that impressive technical work, there wasn't a whole lot of thought given to the passenger story or the airline story. So a ticket on Concorde in today's dollars would set you back about $20,000 round trip New York to London. And you know, $20,000, that's, you know, for most people, that's a bucket list item. That's not transportation. And with 100 seats on the airplane and $20,000 a pop, you just, you know, you just can't fill it. You know, it's not even for the 1%, it's like for the 0.001%. And so after 27 years of flying, you know, we shut it down in 2003, largely because it was, you know, proving to continually be uneconomic and maintenance costs were going up and there just was no economy of scale. And so we went backwards. And again, how funny is that? Imagine if you know, Apple got on stage and said, hey, meet next year's iPhone. It's got this neat rotary feature and it clicks when you dial it. But you know, that's literally what we've done in airplanes. We've gone backwards to that capability we have in the 1960s. And you know, and today we get excited as passengers when there's maybe some mood lighting or, you know, peanuts come back. I think we can do better. You know, we're left, you know, and this matters again. It's not about how fast you can go. It's not about setting speed records. It's about enabling where you can go on the planet and what you can do. It's about breaking the barrier of time to experiencing the planet. So I'll tell a little bit of the story of Boom getting started. This is, you know, quite honestly for me, been a dream for more than 10 years. And for a long time I had on my to-do list a little item that said, figure out how to launch an aviation company. And I kind of did nothing on it for a while. And after having left Groupon about 5 years ago, I knew I wanted to go found another company. And you know, something you learn as an entrepreneur is there's no such thing as an easy startup. They're all hard. And what often makes the difference is have you picked a mission that inspires enough people that you can get great humans to come with you and make the impossible possible. It's something that motivates yourself to keep going no matter what the challenges are. And so I started looking at everything I might work on in order of, frankly, how excited would I be if it worked? And leaving aside, you know, virtually everything else. So I thought I would get 2 weeks into the research on supersonics and find out why no one was doing this. I thought, you know, it's either a bad idea or it's impossible or something like that. But what I found was that there was a whole bunch of, you know, effectively stale conventional wisdom. First off, this isn't impossible. It's been done before. And if you look at Concorde and you say, well, it was a gas guzzler. It was environmentally unfriendly. It didn't work. But you know, how much did it miss by? And actually, all the data you need to answer this question is in Wikipedia. And you can go build a, you know, a three-line spreadsheet that tells you the answer. To go from Concorde to economy class fares is a big leap. But you know, today we have a jumping off market that's kind of in between. We've got this thing called business class, which by the way was really invented, the lay flat bed in business class was invented in 2001 by British Airways, so really just a couple years before Concorde retired. So we now have this notion of you know, beds in the sky, and it's a little crazy, but you need the bed because the flight is so darn long. And if you say, well, how could I get started in supersonics? And maybe I could target that market. And what if I made flights fast enough that you wouldn't need a bed in the sky, but a, you know, a seat would do it? It turns out that, well, long story short, that works. And to make this happen, you only need to beat Concorde on fuel efficiency by about 30%. And if you look and say, well, Concorde was designed literally 50 years ago. 50 years ago, with slide rules and wind tunnels and drafting paper. And while we haven't had a speed up since the 1960s, it turns out we have changed out the entire technology stack for airplanes. We've gone from defining aerodynamics and wind tunnels, where, you know, every iteration will take you months and cost millions of dollars, and you have to have a huge budget to do it, and you can't try very many ideas, to simulation-based aerodynamic development, where every iteration takes you maybe half an hour and could be done on a startup-sized budget. And so you could do hundreds or thousands of iterations instead of dozens. Secondly, materials have completely changed. So we've gone from aluminum to carbon fiber composites. And you know, we really owe a thank you to, you know, Boeing and Airbus for pioneering that on the 787 and on the A350. But what's interesting is that carbon composites are actually more significant for supersonics than they are for subsonic. Okay, why is that? Well, so first off, they're much better at handling high temperatures. And the faster you fly, the hotter the airplane gets. So at Mach 2.2, you're effectively swimming in 300 degree air. And so it's really hot. And aluminum starts to get kind of mushy. And you know, the last thing you want is a mushy airplane. It's not really great. Also, aluminum grows. So hotter it gets, the more it expands. You know, famously on Concorde, the airplane would actually get 15 inches longer in flight. On the last flights, the captains took their hats off and put them in the expansion gaps in the airplane, so they'd be trapped there for the rest of history. But carbon composites basically don't grow with temperature. And so that means, you know, you can you don't have to build a machine that's going to get bigger on the outside and stay the same size on the inside and still have to be airtight. It gets a lot simpler, and it lets you build a very fluid aerodynamic shape. So you can take a computer simulation, you can come up with this very sophisticated, very efficient shape, and then you can actually build it in a strong, lightweight structure that can take high temperatures. And last but not least is we've completely changed how jet engines work. So Concorde was the only passenger aircraft to fly with afterburners. And if you don't know what an afterburner is, it's kind of like strapping a rocket engine to the back of your jet engine. And it's really cool because there's a flame coming out the back. It's, you know, it's beautiful, especially at night. And you can't miss it when it goes by because it's rip-roaring loud. But if you put on your airline hat or your passenger hat, right, this isn't so great because the flame is kind of scary. The noise causes people to call Congress. And you know, if you're in the airline, you really hate your fuel bill because this thing is insanely inefficient. On Concorde, they flip on the afterburners. It was plus 78% fuel flow for plus 17% thrust. So not really a very efficient way to fly. But again, they were working with the best of 1960s technology, and they were taking military engines and adapting them for a commercial aircraft. But today we've got something, you know, way better. We've got something called a turbofan, right? And that's like a little jet engine with a big fan on front. And it's dramatically quieter. It's dramatically more fuel efficient. And it turns out to be, it's a myth that you need afterburners to go supersonic. You just don't. What you need is enough thrust to overcome the drag so you can push through the sound barrier and accelerate up to speed. So again, if you can take all these technologies, and this is, again, these are all things that are flying on other airplanes today. If you take all those technologies and you add them up, you say, what can I do? Well, we can beat Concorde by enough to make this work for business class kind of economics. And again, that's the starting point for us. It's not the destination, but it's a foothold. And just the same way that we've seen cell phones and computers and electric cars start with a relatively, you know, smaller market for a certain segment of people, and that allows the development and the investment to happen, that the cost could come down over time and eventually become mainstream, what we're going to see is the same thing for supersonics. So when we said it, boom, what is our view of the very first airplane? We call it Overture because it is the opening to a trip, to experience on the planet, and it's also the first of what will ultimately be a series of aircraft. They get progressively faster, quieter, and more affordable to more people. The way to think of Overture is we kind of took the front cabin off of a Boeing or Airbus, and we chopped it off and made it go really fast. And so from an airline perspective, this economically looks like the most profitable cabin that you already have. It's the highest margin passengers, you fly the most, and the operating costs on a per seat mile can be the same or in some cases even better than what's flying today. And with between 55 and 75 seats on the airplane, you know, if you can fly a wide body aircraft and fill your seats and earn a profit, make the route work economically, you can fly Overture on that same route and fill the seats and make money. So let's actually talk a little bit about the routes. One of the key insights here is that you don't have to solve the overland supersonic problem in order to get started. Historically, that's been an assumption, and I think largely because historically the assumption has been that When Supersonic comes back, it'll be a private jet for the ultra wealthy, and those have to follow the billionaire around and go wherever the billionaire goes, which is mostly over land. And so that development's been held back because of the overland supersonic issue. But airlines, as we all know, are very used to taking specialized equipment and putting on specialized routes. So if you focus on routes that are mostly transoceanic, where you can fly 85-90% of the route over water, unrestricted, where the question of sonic boom is just not an issue, turns out there are 500 routes that have enough traffic for daily supersonic service. And that 500 routes turns into a market for 1,000 or 2,000 of our airplanes. So that means there's a big enough market here that, number one, you can really change the way tens of millions of people get around the planet, and you can earn return for your investors and your suppliers who are want to see that this is not just cool, but actually something that makes financial and economic sense. So let's talk about some of those routes. And the theme I want you to all hear here is it's not about less time on airplanes, it's about what you can do. So New York to London, as we all know today, that's about a 7-hour flight. You usually fly it as a red eye, leave New York at night, get to Heathrow in the morning. We'll be able to do that in 3 hours and 15 minutes. And that's important because it actually takes that red eye flight and turns it into a daytime flight. So instead of leaving New York at night, you probably leave in the morning. First departure from New York in the morning gets you to Heathrow about 2:15 in the afternoon, London time, which means you have enough time to get to central London and do some business, and if you want to, catch a flight back home, and you're back in London in time to have dinner with your kids and tuck them into bed on that same day. So a trip that would be a minimum of 2 days today turns into a day trip. And enables you to have a lot more conversations and meetings in person versus on the phone or on video conference. So let's take an example from the Pacific. So San Francisco to Tokyo. As many of you may know, we have a partnership with Japan Airlines who pre-ordered 20 of our aircraft. And so the San Francisco to Tokyo flight I know really, really, really well. And oftentimes I'd go to Tokyo for just one meeting. And it would be worth it. And so the way that works today is you actually have to leave midday Saturday. You get there end of day Sunday, Tokyo time. You get in a hotel room and you try to sleep, right? And then you wake up Monday morning for your meeting. You try not to sleep in your meeting. And then you catch a haul back. And the whole thing takes 3 calendar days. And you better not make any more decisions that week because you're kind of jet lagged and messed up. So when that flight that today is 11, 12 hours turns into more like 5.5, what's interesting is the schedules change too. So instead of leaving Saturday, you leave Sunday. And a Sunday morning departure from San Francisco gets you there Monday morning, Tokyo time. So to you, it's early afternoon. Everyone in Tokyo is awake. You can do a half day of meetings, overnight flight on the way back, and bam, you're back in the US 24 hours after you left with your business done, and no jet lag because you got back before you had to transition time zones. And one last example. So LA to Sydney, today that's 15 hours, and it's almost like, who wants to go to Australia? It's so far away. It's actually like Honolulu before jets. And so on Supersonic, that 15-hour flight is now less than 7, and you can fall asleep in Sydney and wake up in LA. And again, it's not about the time saving. Start to imagine what happens to the world when all of a sudden Australia and New Zealand are not quite so far away. So that's the airplane, and that's what it will be able to do. Let's talk a little bit about the passenger experience. So is anyone in the room flown on Concorde? All right, we have a few. So the experience was like sort of economy today, but they would serve you like caviar and champagne. It wasn't super comfortable, even though the flight was short. And we've been able to find enough efficiency relative to Concorde that we can put some of that into reducing the fares and making the economics better. But we can also put some of that into building a more spacious interior that's better for passengers. So this is the new business class, and it's designed for daytime flights. So you've got plenty of space to sort of spread out and work or relax, and a great big window where you can actually see the curvature of the Earth. It's going to be gorgeous. And this is what the inside of the airplane looks like. So supersonic airplanes want to be long and skinny for efficiency reasons. So there's one seat on each side of the aisle, which means you don't have to choose window seat or aisle seat. Everyone gets both. And we're doing away with overhead bins and expanding underseat storage instead. So you don't have to worry about where your bag goes. There's always a space just for your seat. Now for those flights that today are 16, 17, 18 hours that turn into, you know, the more pleasant sort of red eye supersonic, you can also put a lay flat bed on the airplane. So you can go to sleep in LA and wake up in Sydney. All right, so that's the story for Overture. Now, of course, Boom is a relatively young company. We're about 150 people today, and aircraft are amongst the most complex safety critical machines that humanity's ever built. So where do you start? And the way we're starting at Boom is we've designed Overture, and then we've said, okay, let's take everything that makes Overture work, shrink it down to a 1/3 scale prototype, and let's go build and fly that. And so that's what we call XB1 demonstrator, or Baby Boom for short. And so Baby Boom is what we're building this year, literally as we speak. And all of the key technology that you need to go in this airplane has been validated in hardware testing. So late last year, we finished our wind tunnel testing. We've done 3 subsonic wind tests and 1 supersonic wind tunnel test, which established that the airplane is safe and controllable and efficient enough at a wide range of speeds. We've run our engines. So we're based in Denver, and down the road at Colorado Springs, the Air Force Academy has an engine test cell that happens to be designed for the exact engine that we're using on XB1. And so we've put it through its paces. And one of the exciting things we've been able to do there is actually run it through its paces, not just with jet fuel, but also with low carbon alternative fuels. So the supersonic future doesn't have to guzzle gas. It can actually be biofuels ready. And we'll be able to see that on XB1. And we've started constructing the airplane itself. This is the tooling for the XB1 fuselage. And as we speak, the wings are under construction, the cockpit's under construction, the horizontal tail's under construction, and we're starting assembly in just a couple months at our facility in Centennial. And this aircraft is going to fly, you know, well within a year. It's incredibly exciting. And when that happens, we'll have built history's first independently developed supersonic jet. And yeah, it sort of looks like a sports car, but it proves all the key technologies we need for Overture. And it proves that this baby little startup company with a shoestring budget compared to the giants can actually build a supersonic aircraft. So I'll take a step back and remind everyone of why we're doing this. It's not about going really fast. It's about enabling human connection. It's about changing what you can do on the planet, about changing meetings that would be phone conferences into in-person meetings to allow you to fall in love with someone from another continent. All right, so I will stop there, and I imagine there are lots of questions, and I'd be happy to take some of them. Yeah, so there are really two noise, the question is what about noise? And there are really two noise challenges associated with supersonic airplanes. The most famous is sonic boom, which is the noise you hear whenever a supersonic airplane flies over at high speed. And then the other one is associated with takeoff and landing noise. And so this comes back to, you know, Concorde having flown with afterburners, and they're not quiet. So our approach is, number one, to start by focusing on landing and takeoff noise. So this can be friendly to airport communities, and with those turbofan engines that we're using, it's not going to be any louder than aircraft that are flying today. So if you live around an airport and Overture flies over, you won't really know that it's different from, you know, any other aircraft flying today. So there's no downside there. On Sonic Boom, Overture is going to be quieter than Concorde. I think the issue is a little bit exaggerated. As you know, we didn't actually have a ban on sonic booms in the U.S. until the American competitor to Concorde was canceled, and then we can't have this sonic stuff. So I think we'll see over time that the aircraft get progressively quieter, and we'll have to figure out as an industry how quiet is quiet enough to make it work. And we'll see over time how that goes. But as I said, we're starting by focusing on transoceanic routes, where the sonic boom question is just moot. Yes?
I'm curious, since we're here at a RTCA standards organization, to hear from you whether or not you feel that the current aviation standards we have enable or hinder what you're trying to do, whether there's specific limitations in terms of how the airspace is being managed, particularly in terminal areas or spacing going over the oceans. I suspect we may be flying at higher altitudes than most transport traffic, but What's your take on the standards environment?
The standards environment. So, high level, it's really good. The technology policy we have at Boom is nothing goes on this airplane unless it's been flown safely and certified on other airplanes. And the magic of doing this in 2019 is you can have that restriction and everything you need actually exists. Now, there are places, there are places where there's opportunity for improvement. And in particular, supersonic aircraft are capable of advanced procedures around airport communities that actually lower noise footprints. For example, they're more efficient at a steeper approach angle, which would reduce the practical noise footprint around airport communities. And you can do things like accelerating takeoffs and automatic power reserve, again, that kind of improve the actual noise impact on communities by leveraging things about supersonic aircraft that are different than subsonic, like the fact that they have additional reserve thrust at low speed. And so something we would love to do is see the standards updated that allow us to take advantage of those procedures and fly them in practice and reduce the noise impact that aviation has on our community. So there's work to do there. The high altitude operations is some place where there's a bit of work to do, but the good news is you're kind of fighting downhill because you fly faster the higher you fly, and so the high speed lanes will be on top of the low speed lanes, and it's not nearly as difficult as the challenges we have at low altitude for UAVs. So from a policy perspective, I think supersonics is actually a lot easier than a lot of the other innovation that we're talking about here. Yes.
I'm curious about what altitude are you anticipating to be flying the aircraft at, and what type of runway lengths do you need? Because the Concorde needed a lot of runway.
Mm-hmm. So what about runway, and when will this fly? So I'll start with the schedule. Everyone always wants to know how soon can we have this. So XB-1 is going to fly within a year, and then our target is to have the first passenger flights in the mid-2020s. So it's about 6 years from flying XB-1 to be able to carry our first passenger on Overture. And non-airplane people tend to ask me, why in the world does that take so long? And airplane people say, how in the world can you do it that fast? And the answer to both is, this is, as we know in this room, an incredibly complex, safety-critical process that there are a whole lot of steps to take, and we're not gonna skip any of them. We're gonna do all of them. On one hand. On the other hand, it's not new technology development. We don't need to take something out of the lab and commercialize it, which is why we're talking about a few years and not about decades. And I'm sorry, I'm forgetting the second part of your question.
Runway,
yes. If you can land a 777, you can land an Overture jet. So this is, in some ways, the anti-A380. It's designed to be easy to adopt into the system that we have today. So it'll work in a narrow-body gate. It'll work on runways of 10,000 feet. So kind of any major international airport can handle this aircraft just fine. And you can do special things for it, but you don't need to. So it can slot right in. Hi.
One of the challenges when the A380 was introduced was wake separation, which ended up actually reducing capacity at airports where it was introduced, and at busy airports that was a challenge. How do you foresee this being introduced? Are you going to be targeting major airports? Are you going to target outlying airports which don't have the congestion, or what do you think your customers are going to be targeting?
We'll be targeting the primary airports that everyone flies out of today. So this won't be outlying airports. It'll be, we want to go places where the passengers are, because it's not about how fast you fly. It's about how easily can you get from point A to point B. And wake separation, fortunately, this is a relatively small airplane compared to the A380. So there's a lot less disturbance and energy going into the air. And the nature of the vortex flow over a delta wing actually allows some of those to break up more quickly. So there isn't the wake separation issue from like there was in the A380. In fact, with higher approach speeds, you can actually increase capacity in some cases.
Thank you for the presentation. You talked and implied in the first generation product about expanding that in terms of capabilities. Mm-hmm. Curious for your thoughts on the current limitations for the technologies you're using as you get faster and so forth, specifically mm-hmm. engine technology. What is the limit of turbofan for speed? When do you start looking at additional developments, ramjet, mm-hmm. scramjet, and so forth to to go faster and achieve more. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, so how do you get faster and cheaper? Well, I'll tell you our secret plan. So if history is any guide, when you enable faster flights, more people go more places more often. And that means that this 55 to 75 seat airplane we're starting with is actually gonna be too small. And we'll need to build a second generation aircraft, the encore to our overture, that will be larger. So think 80, 100, 150 seats. And when you go larger for supersonic, even more so than subsonic, naturally the costs come down. So you've got two pilots amortized across a larger number of passengers. You can also do things with the aerodynamics that you just can't do in a smaller airplane. The front of the cabin wants to be bigger, the back of the cabin wants to be skinnier, and you can't get that ratio that you want in a small airplane because us humans are the size that we are. But you can do it in a larger aircraft. You can do three or four across up front, two across in the back, that starts to work. And so that larger airplane can be more fuel efficient, lower cost to operate, which means fares can come down, which means more people can go more places more often. So more demand, larger airplane, more efficient airplane, lower fares, more travel, and you start to get this flywheel spinning. And if you look at the overall cost profile of travel, most of the costs are proportional not to the distance traveled, but the time spent traveling. So the cost of pilots and crew and catering and maintenance, rent on the aircraft, these are all proportional to block hours, right? Not to miles. And so when you go faster, those costs naturally come down. And so you make enough progress in fuel economy, this effect that I call the speed dividend starts to kick in, and the faster flight can actually be the cheaper one. And there's line of sight to doing that in our lifetimes. And as you start to grow the market for supersonics, all of a sudden, as you're indicating, the investment starts to happen in enabling technologies. Things like variable cycle engines, which think of it as a turbofan that can effectively morph into a turbojet at high speed. These things are kind of on the drawing boards today, and they're not getting commercialized because there's no market. But variable cycle engines, advanced aerodynamics, newer materials, these are things that enable you to go faster at lower cost. And those investments will start to happen as this market happens, and as the market grows, the investments will ramp, and you'll naturally see the efficiencies. And I think we're going to see a time in our lifetimes where the fastest flight is actually the cheapest one. And then we'll convert all of our subsonic aircraft into cargo.
Thank you for the presentation. Just had a question about the human-machine interface. How is that going to, how are you training pilots, and mm-hmm. how does that work into your vision for this right. technology?
Pilot training. So it's not going to be anything terribly different from what we have today in subsonic. Our goal is to make learning to fly overture like going from an Airbus to a Boeing. And Concorde had a three-person flight crew, had a flight engineer, because they didn't have computers. And today you can take all the sophistication of managing a supersonic aircraft and do it through software rather than through more humans. And so the transition can be relatively easy. This is not something where you're gonna need a bunch of military test pilots to do it. It'll be the most exciting thing in the sky to fly, but it actually won't be all that different. All right, well, thank you all very much. Pleasure speaking with you.